By Digvijay Singh, General Secretary of the Congress Party. Mr. Singh, you have been saying that Mr. Gandhi, the Vice President of Congress, should be seen more in the leadership role and he should take charge of the affairs of the party. What exactly do you mean by that?
Exactly what I've said. He should be more hands-on. And I think it is high time he took over as the President of the ICC. Of course, under the mentor and the leadership of Mrs. Sonia Gandhi.
But why do you say that? He's the Vice President of the Congress
yes,
Party
but then
and he has a carte blanche.
No, he doesn't. That's the problem.
Why do you say that? On what premise you are saying that he doesn't have a carte blanche?
Because it is only President AICC who has that.
So will it really make a difference, Mr. Singh, if Rahul Gandhi becomes the President of the Congress Party?
Well, I feel that he has to be more hands-on. And of course, he has it in him. It's only that he has to be given full responsibility.
And you are saying that by giving that designation, it will make a difference to the party and the way Mr. Gandhi is functioning.
This is what I perceive.
Are you going to raise this issue in the Congress Working Committee, which is going to
meet very shortly? It depends on the agenda of the Central Work, CWC.
But that's the highest decision-making body.
Yes, it is, but we have to work within the agenda.
You are saying that he needs to be hands-on. But Mr. Singh, if you see the past 6 months in Parliament, he did not make a single intervention.
And this is what my complaint is. I've complained to him also. He should have been more active in the Parliament.
He should be heard more?
Absolutely. Heard more, seen more, and travel more.
Something like Bhatta Parsol, which he did, sort of
Bhatta Parsol was for one specific thing. And I think because of that, we came out with a very, very pro-farmer, very progressive Land Acquisition Act, because he applied his mind and we got a very fine law, which was unanimously adopted by the Lok Sabha and the Raj Sabha. Now, of course, BJP is, of course, as usual, doing a U-turn.
But Mr. Singh, people would say that, designations are what you make of them. But do you really feel that by becoming a president or, taking a top position in the party really makes a long-run difference in the way people behave? And how?
It makes a difference. For example, in a media house, the difference between a chief editor and an editor is vital, because the chief editor is where the buck stops. So this is where we would like Mr. Rahul Gandhi to be the hands-on AICC president.
What sort of, you said that you had a conversation with him on these issues. What do you really expect from Mr. Gandhi to be doing so that he is heard more or seen more?
Well, I've been saying this for a long time, and he has to choose his own timing. But I feel that, you see, in the age of 24/7 media, he has to be heard more, seen more, and more proactive within the parliament also.
But he wasn't even there on the foundation day, when every person of the Congress Party was
even there. I was not there, because I attended the foundation day ceremony in my state. So it depends on the convenience of every leader.
But if you are you saying, Mr. Singh, that the shift in the generation is the real key to the solution of the Congress Party?
Yes. Congress Party has always encouraged younger people to take charge. Even during my tenure as a PCC president, we were all between 35 to 45. Mm-hmm. So I think that the time has come now. Even Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru became the AICC president at the age of 38. Mrs. Indira Gandhi in the early 40s. So I think the time has come now. Maulana Abul Kalam Azad became even younger, 37. So time has now come for the younger generation to take charge.
But then Congress president continues to be the most acceptable leader of the UPA.
That she is, and she would always remain so.
Then what sort of a role do you envisage for Sonia Gandhi when, if you say Rahul should become the president of the Congress?
Yes. So then, she remains the leader of the Congress Party. She remains the leader of the UPA.
and Rahul becomes the president
of the Congress Party.
But even if I take your argument saying that the shift in generation is the key, but you look at the record of Raj Sabha, where all the senior members of the Congress Party are there, it has done far better than the younger Lok Sabha.
It's not that. It's a question of numbers. We have the majority in Raj Sabha. We have a very small number in Lok Sabha. At the same time, this is the first time the BJP has come with an absolute majority.
Mm-hmm.
And a political party since 1985 onwards, this is the first political first government which has a complete
non-Congress party,
which has a complete majority by a non-Congress BJP. But at the same time, the Lok Sabha has been able to, Lok Sabha Congress Parliamentary Party has been able to make its voice heard and has sort of raised issues, very pertinent issues, very relevant issues concerning the national scene in the Lok Sabha.
So you are saying that it's not about the age of the leaders who are present in Raj Sabha, it just boils down to the number.
It's not only that, but at the same time, Raj Sabha also is a house of elders. This is the house of the people. Now, the house of the people represents the mandate in a Lok Sabha. So therefore, you can't say that the Lok Sabha has not performed. Yes, it has performed, but then probably they could not stop the proceedings effectively as we could in Raj Sabha.
How do you look at the recent reverses of the Congress Party in various states?
This is a general trend. If you see after 2004, our winnability was much higher. Even after 2009, our winnability of the state government was much higher than the BJP. So this trend continues for at least 2-3 years after the last Lok Sabha. So probably in the next 2-3 years, things will make difference.
But in your observation, what's the core of this malaise whereby a large chunk of your vote bank has disintegrated? If you look at the larger share, it has really come down.
Forget about vote banks, because I don't really believe in politics of vote banks. Everyone is an individual. What we have suffered in the states is we have not been able to build up a strong, viable regional leadership in the states. This is one of our major weaknesses.
You are saying that it's the absence of a political PCC president that you have not been able to
We have lost out because we have not been able to build up a viable, strong regional leadership in the state. This is one of the major reasons.
A lot of people would say that it is also because of the fact that the mainframe of the Congress Party is not in sync with the Youth Congress, and elections have had a very negative impact on that.
No. Youth Congress, NSUI, elections I support. I'm not one of those who opposes elections. I've always believed in democratic functioning of the party, and which I'm very happy Mr. Rahul Gandhi also agrees. The only thing is the Youth Congress, NSUI and all frontal organizations have to work within the umbrella, under the umbrella of the Congress Party.
Correct.
We can't have multiple memberships. So this is one of the major issues which we are discussing in our roadmap ahead. And I think the second point was that the Youth Congress, NSUI after elections was not allowed to grow and increase its base, organizational base, which they should have been allowed to appoint committees within the assembly segments and within the parliament segments, and also appoint cells and departments of various categories so that larger people could come into the fold of the Youth Congress and SUI.
Can you just explain the point on the issue of multiple memberships so that people can understand?
You see, Congress Party has a membership. You enroll yourself as a member of the Congress Party. Then you have another membership of the Youth Congress where you enroll as a Youth Congress member. There's another membership of the NSUI where you enroll as NSUI member. There's another membership of Mahila Congress where they have separate membership. Seva Dal has a... So these multiple membership, they do not result in a very cohesive political organization. And this is the point which we have been raising.
You said that the roadmap for the party is being prepared. What are the five key challenges for the Congress party you see as of now?
You know, Mr. Rahul Gandhi met almost all of the Congress top leaders.
What are the five key challenges for the Congress party you see as of now?
You know, Mr. Rahul Gandhi met almost all of the Congress top leadership and had series of discussions over more than 200 hours on three basic issues. Number one, what should be our Congress ideology or socio-economic programs in the next decade? Number two, what should be the changes in our organizational structure and functioning in the coming years? And number three, what should be our overall strategy for the road ahead? The fourth issue, he said, was it should be state specific, that each state should draw up its own strategy to build a party in the states. These are the four broad issues on which the, Mr. Rahul Gandhi has been working on.
But the core to this is that the word secularism and the way it is perceived in public has become very, very contested. Where does Congress stand on that?
You know, not only India, but the whole world is facing the problem of radical, rigid, religious fundamentalism of all colors. This is the basic reason for the turbulent, I would say, period that we are going through of terrorism. What happened in France is something which has come about because of the increase in radical thought amongst all religions. This is a dangerous trend for the whole world. Here in our country also we see these radical fundamental fanatics emerging. One of the Sangh Parivar, and the other is the, like people like Asad Owaisi, Akbar Owaisi, Yaqub Qureshi on the other side. But both are on the same page as far as radical fanatic regional thought goes. And I have always said they are two faces of the same coin. One sort of feeds on the other. So therefore, this is one of the major challenges facing this country. Unfortunately, what has happened is that secularism has been wrongly projected as minority appeasement. Congress has always fought this radical religious fanatic thought from the very beginning, even before the India became independent. We were fighting Hindu Mahasabha, RSS on one side and Muslim League on the other side. And this Muslim League leader, Mahmud Ali Jinnah, who was the father of the creation of Pakistan, he was labeled by Mr. Advani and by Mr. Jaswant Singh as a secular leader. Again, the first person who demanded, who sort of started the two nation theory was Savarkar on one side and Muhammad Ali Jinnah later. So these are the people who have divided the body politic of this country. Where was terrorism in this country before the Ram Mandir issue, Babri Masjid issue came up? It was confined to states like Punjab or the northeast, but not in the main cow belt or lower down. You remember always that Mahatma Gandhi fought these radical elements from day one, whether it was Muslim League or it was Hindu Mahasabha RSS. Who killed Mahatma Gandhi? Mahatma Gandhi was killed by a Hindu fanatic who thought that Mahatma Gandhi was destroying this country. This is what I'm trying to say. Today, Mr. Modi got the mandate on the issue of development. Now, where is the issue of development now? The only thing we discussed today is ghar vapsi, conversion, godse, communal riots. Is this the mandate which Mr. Modi has got? Where are the issues of development? the farmers are not getting their due. They are not getting remunerative prices.
Let me interject you here before you reiterate your point. But isn't it ironical that you are speaking so passionately about this issue of communalism? But even your vice president did not address it in Lok Sabha.
He did. He went to the well to ask for a debate.
But where did he speak?
He didn't speak, but the party spoke.
But he didn't speak.
He may not have. But at the same time, he was concerned. He forced the discussion in the Lok Sabha, which was not being taken up. And who opens the debate from the BJP side? Mahant Adityanath. Mahant Adityanath is a rabid, fanatic, religious fundamentalist. And who is going against the very principles of Mahant Goraknath. Mahant Goraknath believed in communal harmony. He believed in respect to all religion. He is going against the very basic tenets of Nath Sampradaya.
Are you saying that the sort of voices which we hear in the larger paraphernalia of NDA is part of the method it's the real thing? Are you trying to say that?
I give full credit to RSS, who have never deviated from their basic principle of a Hindu Rashtra. Although this is not possible in this country with such multi-ethnic, multi-religious diversity. But their agenda has been very clear. BJP has been sort of showing that they are secular, they respect all religions, they don't believe in religious fundamentalism, they are not fanatics. But basically, that is their hidden agenda. After all, what is BJP without RSS?
But then there are a lot of leaders in the Congress party who are also worried about the fact that the Congress is being labeled as anti-Hindu. You have Antony Committee report. You have a couple of leaders
Antony Committee report does not mention this.
No, you have a lot of leaders who feel that, you know, the sort of identification which Congress has done with the minority politics has harmed it.
I don't know whom we are talking of. No one has gone public on that. But at the same time, let me tell you one thing.
But does it concern you, the perception of the party which has been made?
My concern is the perception of the people about the wrong definition of the secularism. I'm concerned about the radical fundamentalism which is now getting into the very secular fabric of this country. I'm concerned about the future of the coming generation, and because they must understand what is happening in Pakistan. Muslims are killing Muslims. What is happening in Iraq? What is happening in Syria? Muslims are killing Muslims. I have always said Wahhabism is driving the Muslims to an end which has become very difficult throughout the world. Therefore, all the liberal Muslims and all the liberals of belong to all kinds of different religion must stand up to fight this religious fanaticism.
But are you relating or comparing the sort of Hindu radicalization which you have spoken about with the sort of radicalization abroad?
Absolutely, yes. Absolutely. This is the core problem of this country today, of the world today.
So you're saying there is no difference between the sort of Hindu radicalism with that of Islamic radicalism?
Absolutely. There is no... They are faces with two coins. Who... Now, again, the role of the developed countries. Who encouraged Taliban? Who funded Taliban? Who encouraged it to grow to a monster? It is the funds coming from some of the developed countries for short political gains.
What is the view of your leader on this issue, since I have not heard him and you work very closely with him?
Well, of what little I know of Mr. Rahul Gandhi and Mrs. Sonia Gandhi, they entirely agree with this.
That's the worldview on this issue?
That is the... You see, this is the... Understand... This is the basic problem which the world is facing today, is of religious... fanatic religious fundamentalism, radical fundamentalism, which is eating into the very vitals of the liberal, modern, secular thought of this world.
Tell me, Mr. Singh, now Congress is in opposition for good 5 years because the government has a simple majority. What should be the thrust of the Congress party? Either go solo in state elections or build anti-BJP coalition or support some political parties from outside? What should be the long run?
Kartikeya, you know, politics is an art of the possible. Within the framework of the ideological structure, we should frame our state-specific policies.
For example, in Delhi, what should be the policy?
We should, we've given a good government for 15 years where people saw Delhi developing into a very modern city. And the kind of the development projects which was taken up by Mrs. Sheila Dixit and the Congress Party 15 years made a definite change in the lifestyle of the people of Delhi. Okay, we lost the election, but we should strive to form government with full majority in the coming election.
But your former Chief Minister Sheila Dixit has developed cold feet. She says if given a chance, we should support Aam Aadmi Party.
You have missed the point. If the Congress doesn't come to power, then what are the options? If there's a fractured mandate like the last time, what are the options? As I told you earlier, politics is an art of the possible. Congress Party cannot support BJP, can it?
Correct.
Then what are the options?
So are you saying that option should also be available if Congress doesn't come to power on
its own? That should not be seen until there is a fractured mandate.
And will Rahul Gandhi be seen campaigning in Delhi?
I don't know. Of course, he'll be campaigning for Delhi. Yes.
Thank you for speaking with
us. Thank you,
all right, there you heard it. Digvijay saying.